Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to you, those who are here and those joining digitally. A couple of announcements as we begin. To let you know that there's a concert towards in aid of the parish. It was the Lindsay Chorale, and that'll be next Saturday on the 13th of May. And they'll also be coming along to join us and help us in our sung worship here on Sunday morning as well. If you give to the parish, particularly over a certain amount, I think it's about 200 or 250, I forget the exact amount, please can you fill in the form which you've got notice on your notice. It helps the parish to claim back tax, and we may as well have a little bit from the government if they're willing to give it to us. And today we return to the Common Cup as directed by our bishop, but I delayed it for a little while so that we could get at least accustomed to things before we return to it. And last but no means least, I know some of you know already because they do it a little bit differently in Cork, and sorry for any confusion by that process, but I'm sad to announce to you that I will be moving on. I'll be moving to the parish of Fan Lobos, centred on Dunmanway in West Cork. I'm sure some of you have heard of Sam Maguire, have you? The cup? Well, he is actually buried in the graveyard of that church. So he was from West Cork. So the whole thing from beginning to end all happened in the blink of an eye, much quicker than I'd ever come across before. My institution date is not yet set in stone, so to speak, but it'll probably be at the end of June. But it's not nothing finalized because I have been unable to speak to Bishop Andrew. But for that's for a good reason, because Bishop Andrew was in Westminster yesterday, assisting at the coronation. So I'm sure that's something that he will treasure, amongst other things, as part of his ministry. It's not every day that you get to assist at a coronation, is it? But today we come together to worship the King of Kings, as we were told yesterday, and the Lord of Lords. And we do so still in the season of Easter, which is why it's in yellow or gold. And we say what's in the bold type on the bottom of that left square. The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Amen. And we continue also with the College for Purity, which we say together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Here with our Lord Jesus Christ says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy on us and write these your laws in our hearts. And as we do, this is being the first day of the week and the beginning of the early in the first day, we return to God and his ways. So let us return and let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace. And in silence before God, we say our prayer of confession and repentance. Let us return to the Lord our God and say to him, Almighty God, our heavenly Father, we have sinned in thought and word and deed, and in what we have left undone. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may walk in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy on you. Pardon, deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We stand to sing our first hymn, well-known Irish hymn, Be Thou My Vision, 643, if you wish to follow it in your hymn books. Let's stand to sing. The Collect, the prayer for this Sunday. Lord of all life and power, who through the mighty resurrection of your Son overcame the old order of sin and death, to make all things new in him, grant that we, being dead to sin and alive to you in Jesus Christ, may reign with him in glory, to whom, with you and the Holy Spirit, be praise and honour, glory and might, now and in all eternity. Amen. We remain standing and we will read the psalm together. You can either follow it on the screen or in your service sheets. In you, O Lord, have I taken refuge. Let me never be put to shame. Deliver me in your righteousness. Incline your ear to me. Make haste to deliver me. Be my strong rock, a fortress to save me. For you are my rock and my stronghold. Guide me and lead me for your name's sake. Take me out of the net that they have laid secretly for me, for you are my strength. Into your hands I commend my spirit, for you have redeemed me, O Lord God of truth. My times are in your hand. Deliver me from the hands of my enemies and from those who persecute me. Make your face to shine upon your servant and save me for your mercy's sake. Amen. Our first reading, our Bible, our second reading actually, is from the book of Acts. Thank you. Please be seated.
A reading from the book of the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 7, beginning at verse 55. But filled with the Holy Spirit, Stephen gazed into heaven and saw the glory of God, and Jesus standing at the right hand of God. Look, he said, I see the heavens opened, and the Son of Man standing at the right hand of God. But they covered their ears, and with a loud shout, all rushed together against him. Then they dragged him out of the city and began to stone him. And the witnesses laid their coats at the feet of a young man named Saul. While they were still stoning Stephen, he prayed, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. Then he knelt down and cried out in a loud voice, Lord, do not hold this sin against them. When he had said this, he died. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let's stand to sing, please. The Holy Gospel according to John, beginning at chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. Lord Jesus Christ, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwellings, places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we will be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, but if you do not, then believe me because of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father. I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If in my name you ask me for anything, I will do it. This is the good news, the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated. I pray, Lord, now as we turn to your word, you would open our ears, our eyes, our hearts. You would draw close to us, and we would draw close to you, Jesus. In your name, amen. Now, this passage is familiar to many of us and is often referred to and spoken on at a funeral, and rightly so. And if you will, when at a funeral, it normally looks at the destination, if you will. But I today want to look at it from a different angle and look not so much at the destination, but our time here now before we get to the destination of salvation, resurrection. I'd like us to take a step back and to look at the reading in the light of the now before we look to the then. And Jesus said of himself, and I think this is the key in the midst of it. See, when I'm reflecting on a Bible reading, I look at it in the version that you have here. I normally read it in another version to see it, if you will, from a different angle. I often look at the passages around it, and then the other readings often inform what this is saying, and this is no different. But in any one passage, the Spirit seems to say to me, this is the bit that really opens it up. It's like a key in a lock. When you turn it, you open it, it opens up the understanding. And the key in this case is Jesus's phrase saying the way, and in the J.B. Phillips, he talks about the road, but also the truth and the life. Jesus said, no one can come to the Father except through and along and via him as the way, as the road. There are many routes in this world, but Jesus said he is the way. He's also said he is the truth, which is an encouragement and yet a challenge in these times, because there are many truths out there. But what is the purpose behind them? Where are they coming from? Are they sincere? Are they misguided or whatever? Jesus, we know, is sincere and is good in what he tells us. And then the life. And Jesus speaks about living in us and we in him, living through us, and together we become the body of Christ. So let's look at this for a moment this afternoon. So Jesus said, I am the way, and in the J.B. Phillips, which is another translation of the Bible, speaks of the road. And Jesus often speaks of the journey, and he speaks of a narrow path. He speaks of the camel at the eye of the needle, and the eye of the needle is a gate, probably about the same size as the doors you came in. And the camel has to take off everything he has on his back to get through the door. And Jesus came to show us the way and to show us that we need to return to God, because a lot of us have gone astray. If we think back to last week's reading, the sheep know my voice and the sheep follow me. So Jesus goes ahead. And unlike the shepherds in this part of the world, where they're behind the sheep, they live with the sheep on the hills. And so the shepherd goes ahead and the sheep hear, know, and follow and go with him. Because repentance literally means turning around and going to God. And in the very early church, they'd only do baptism on the Easter Sunday Eve, so the eve before Easter Day, and they would do it, begin at the outside of the church, and they would renounce the old ways, if you will, facing that way, turn around, enter the church via the font, and of course it leads to the table. So Jesus has called us. Do we know him? Do we know his voice? And do we follow him? And Jesus said he is the truth. There's another verse in the Bible, the truth that shall set us free. And Jesus is taught in two primary ways. First, in word. Think of all the parables. The parable of the lost coin, searching high and low. The parable of the mustard seed, how a tiny little faith can work wonders. But what comes to mind particularly is the parable of the Samaritan, and how God has reached out and gone beyond what was expected. And another favorite parable of mine is the parable of the prodigal son. I'm a visual person, and I read a book once on it, and it was by Henry Nguyen, a Canadian French priest. And he sat in the hermitage in Russia and for several weeks looked and meditated upon Rembrandt's picture of the prodigal son. And he reflected as he sat there before God, who am I in that picture? Am I the father who feels hurt by what has happened? And yet I am willing to receive and be embraced like he embraced the son, to be reconciled? Or am I like the prodigal son, who likes to do it like Frank Sinatra, I did it my way, and realize my way really wasn't so good in the first place, and I need to be humble and return to God? Or am I like the older brother, going, well, I have tried to follow you faithfully, God, and you don't seem to be paying attention to me, and I feel slighted and hurt. And God said, you've always been mine. You are still mine, and you will remain mine. And what is mine is yours. Who am I in that picture? But Jesus is also taught through deed. Think of the many times he brought healing and wholeness. Also think of the times when he did healing. He often said, your sins are forgiven, and then physically healed. He reconciled the person to their maker, to our maker, and then made them physically whole. And to me, that demonstrates a God of care, compassion, and consideration. So Jesus' truth is a powerful one and demonstrated in many ways. And then Jesus said he is the life, and he speaks about our life being transformed. We come to that way in a minute. He speaks about another parable of being yeast. Anybody here ever done a baking with yeast? Well, if you put yeast in, what happens to the dough? Does it stay as it is? It rises. But what if the yeast is bad? It goes sour, it goes bad. I know it's trendy to have sourdough bread, but it's not really my cup of tea, to be honest with you. But Jesus is saying that little bit of goodness has a huge impact, but equally a bit of badness can have a big impact as well. And so Jesus' life in us and our life in him, we are found together in perfect communion. Again, as a visual person, I think of, and we spoke about this last night, of Rublev's icon to the Trinity. Imagine in your mind's eye, if you will, you have a table. You have the Father, or you have the Son on the right-hand side. You have the Spirit, and you have the Father. Yet there's a gap at the table. And the gap at the table is for us to be welcomed back into the fellowship of God. So we're with God, and God is with us. But coming back to the way, we're just after Easter. Jesus died on the cross so that the barrier between us and God would be removed. Which direction did the curtain tear from on that day of crucifixion? From the bottom or from the top? From the top. God says, right, the barrier is now removed. He ripped it from top to bottom. He opened the way back to God, that we might approach him and be with him. Because the Bible is a little bit the want of a better phrase, vague about what heaven looks like. But what is clear is that at the end of all things, God will come to be with his people and his people will be with him. It's not necessarily on clouds with harps and wings and playing merry tunes on our harp. What it really is God with us and us with God. And God is perfect and pure, but we're often not. He is the white, we are the dark. But as the Bible says, through the blood of the Lamb, we are made whiter than snow. So that led me all the way around to thinking anew about this passage. In my room, there are many mentions that Jesus has prepared a place for us. And what might that look like? Have any of you here been abroad and had your passport stamped? Well, for me, what came to my mind's eye in relation to this passage is that even though we're not yet in heaven with God, when we accept Jesus as the way, the truth, and the life, it's as if our passport now has been stamped for there. So rather than it being blank like that, it's like that. We've been sealed by the blood of Christ, and we have turned to Jesus, and we become citizens of heaven here, even though we're not there yet. And the reading from Acts spoke to me in relation to that. I can't for a moment imagine that stoning to death was anywhere nice or comfortable for Stephen. And yet look at his response. He seems to look up and see the heaven that he will be with God. Don't count this against him. He sees the redemption, completion, and wholeness he will be in God, even though he's literally being stoned to death. He sees his citizenship. He knows his passport has been stamped. So therefore, that left me to ask a question, because beside him was Paul holding the coats. He hadn't accepted and returned to the way of God as yet, become Saul, become Paul. Your passport page, is it stamped or is it empty? Have you said, I accept Jesus as the way, the truth, the life, my Savior, my Lord, my Christ, my Messiah, my living God? Or is the passport open, waiting to be stamped? Amen. Let us continue in prayer, please.
Let us pray to our risen Saviour on behalf of the Church, the world, and all people according to their need. Heavenly Father, thank you for the godly impact of the witness of Stephen, whose mind was stayed on Christ, who was filled with the Holy Spirit and spent his life pointing people to Jesus as he preached the gospel among the people. We pray that we too might learn lessons both from his life and his death, and from the witness of the early disciples who were ready to stand firm on the gospel of truth and die for their faith. In the midst of an increasing secular world, we pray that it is the desire of your worldwide church to do your perfect will and submit to serving you in spirit and in truth. Like Stephen, there are many even today who are persecuted and tortured for proclaiming you as Lord. Give them the grace and strength that you gave Stephen as he fearlessly spoke your truth in love. Forgive and prayed for his enemies, and remain faithful to Christ and to the end. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we pray for the meeting of the General Synod of the Church of Ireland in Wexford this coming weekend, for the President of General Synod, the Most Reverend John McDowell, Archbishop of Armagh and Primate of all Ireland, and for the House of Bishops. We pray for the presence of the Holy Spirit to be present in all proceedings, and that Synod members, clerical and laity, would be guided to make wise decisions that uphold the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pray for Bishop Andrew, Reverend Adam, and all clergy in the Derry and Raphoe Diocese as they attend Synod. May they, on their return, be strengthened to remain steadfast in the work that you have given them to do. Help them to be faithful to preach the gospel and to stand firm on the faithfulness of your holy word without compromise. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. As the Lord Jesus comforted his disciples and said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." When times of stress and anxiety come our way, how soon we fall away and how quick we are to blame God for our misfortune. Forgive us, Lord, when we are stressed, overwhelmed, and unsure, and we forget to place our trust in you. Forgive us for failing to acknowledge the blessed assurance and hope that we are offered through the love you have for each of us. Lord, draw us back to yourself by comforting us and reminding us that in believing in you, you are the one who has the power over everything. Challenge us to find renewed purpose in following in the footsteps of Christ, so that in our living and loving, your kingdom of love is revealed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator God, we pray for the world and for the day-to-day worries of living with war and climate change. Forgive us when we are complacent in our attitude to these matters, despite the huge relevance to our lives. Help us to protect the world in our prayers and through our actions. We pray for those fleeing war and political persecution, that they may find refuge and safety from all dangers in countries that open their borders with compassion. God of peace, we pray for a settlement to the war in Ukraine, for cessation of violence between Israel and Palestine, for Sudan, Ethiopia, Myanmar, and for reconciliation of civil wars in countries in the Middle East and throughout the world where terrorist insurgency persists. Lord of justice, bless with your wisdom those who work for peace. Give them the grace to challenge and change our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Loving Lord, we pray for those who feel lost or alone, those who live with anxiety or doubt their own value, and all who cannot imagine a purpose for themselves. Help us identify the needy and lead us to the lonely, the family struggling to eat, and those who fear the cost of living crisis. Make us mindful of those who are alone and have no family life, those living in hostels or provision centres, those living on the streets, and those whose lives are dominated by drugs and alcohol. Forgive us, Lord, for those times we forget that we should love our neighbour as ourselves. Give us joy in serving you and all people, unafraid to reach out to show your love and enable your healing to take place in our community and in our world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Healing Lord, we ask your blessing on our family members and friends as we pray for those who are sick or housebound. Be especially near to those who have recently received a life-changing diagnosis, those with terminal illness, those with anxiety and depression who feel they cannot cope, those scarred by wounds that long years of chronic ill health have afflicted upon them, for those who are confused or afraid, for those in hospitals and nursing homes, for all who are dealing with long-term disabilities or special needs. Lord, show us ways of sharing with them the fellowship and hope we find in you. Uphold them and grant them your strength and peace as they live out each day. We take a moment to pray in the stillness of our hearts for those known to us who are unwell at present, either in our families or in the wider community. And in our prayers this week, let us bring before God Robert and Georgina, Annie and George, Jeffrey, Mary Jo, Pat, and Roisin. Lord Jesus, we pray that you will bless all those we have prayed for with your loving care, renew their strength, and heal what ails them in your precious name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of eternity, we often hear your promise at funerals, "If I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, for where I am, you may be also." Thank you, Jesus, for being the way to your Father's house, the truth that sets us free, and the life that raises us out of sin and death. We remember those who have recently died, having sealed their lives for eternity by the blood of Christ. And as we face our own spiritual death one day, we pray that we will have the same faith in Jesus, redeeming us from sin and spiritual death. God of love and mercy, embrace all those whose hearts ache today and are overflowing with grief and with a sense of loss. We remember those families in our church family, and especially the Sheeran family circle, as they mourn the death of a much loved mother and grandmother. Father God, be with them in their sorrow. Uphold them with your strength, and may they know that they are not alone in their struggle, but you are with them every moment of every painful day. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father God, we thank you that you do not treat us as our sins deserve. Help us in the coming week to prayerfully consider how you poured out your love for us through Jesus Christ, who gave up everything for us on the cross, that by placing our faith in Jesus, we are rescued, redeemed, given new life, and the assurance of eternal life through Christ's resurrection. And we say together, Merciful Father, accept these our prayers for the sake of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. Let us stand together as we affirm our faith with the words of the Creed. Let's stand together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Jesus said, "A new commandment I give you, that you love one another, even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Bear with me while I do the final preparation of the table. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us celebrate the feast. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Father, almighty and ever-living God, at all times and in all places, it is right to give you thanks and praise. Above all, we praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us. By dying, he destroyed our death, and by rising, he restored our life. And so with all your people, with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name forever, praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed are you, Father, the creator and sustainer of all things. You made us in your own image, male and female, you created us. And even when we turned away from you, you never ceased to care for us. But in your love and your mercy, you freed us from the slavery of sin, giving your only begotten Son to become man and to suffer death on the cross to redeem us. He made there the one complete and all-sufficient sacrifice of the sins of the whole world. He instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until he comes again. On the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to the disciples, said, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And when he given thanks to them, he said, Drink this, all of you, for this is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Therefore, Father, with this bread and this cup, we do as Christ your Son commanded. We remember his passion and death. We celebrate his resurrection and ascension, and we look for the coming of his kingdom. Accept through him, our great high priest, this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And as we eat and drink these holy gifts, grant by the power of the life-giving Spirit that we may be made one in your holy church and partakers of the body and blood of your Son, that he may dwell in us and we in him, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. We being many are one body, for we all share in the one bread. Draw near with faith and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood which he shed for you. Remember he died for you, and feed in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Solid ground, and through the mercy.
Let's say together this prayer. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit, Holy Spirit, to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. We come to our final hymn. I don't think we've actually taken up our collection, so we'll do that now. Go forth and tell, O Church of God Awake. I hope I've got the right number. I think it should be number 478 if you wish to follow this in your hymn books.
Go forth and tell, O Church of God Awake.
By whose glory Christ was raised from the dead, strengthen you by his life-giving Spirit to walk with him in the paths of righteousness and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Go in the peace of the risen Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.